briny cat hath mewed?
Thrice and once the hedge pick whined.
Harpier cries, tis time, tis time. Round about the cold we go, in the poison entrails throw. Toad, that under cold stone, days and night hath 31. Swelter than unsleepy gods, boil thou first of a chalk butt.
Double, toil and trouble, fire burn and cold rim bubble.
Fillet of a finny snake, in the cauldron boil and bake. Eye of newt, and toe of frog. Wool of bat. And tongue of dog. Adder's fork. And blind worm's sting. Lizard's leg. And owlet's wing. For a charm of powerful trouble, like a hell broth boil and bubble.
Witch's mummy. Maw and gulp of the raven salt sea shark. Root of hemlock. Digged in the dark. Liver of blaspheming Jew. Gall of goat. And slips of you. Slivered in the moon's eclipse. Nose of Turk and Tartar's lips. Finger of birth-strangled babe, ditch delivered by a drab. Make the gruel thick and slab. Add thereto a tiger's chaudron. Pour the ingredients of our cauldron.
Poor innocent.
sweat, taken from the murderer's gibbet, thrown to the flame, come high or low, thyself and all this deathly show.
Tell me, thou unknown power.
Macbeth, 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 beware Macduff, beware the Thane of Fife, dismiss me enough.
Whate'er thou art, for thy precaution takes, thou hast taught my fear aright. But one word more.
He shall not be commanded.
By 3 ears I'd hear thee.
Be bloody, bold, and resolute. Laugh to scorn the power of man, for none of woman born shall harm Macbeth.
Then live, Macduff. What need I fear of thee? And yet, I'll make assurance double sure and take a bond of fate. Thou shalt not live that I may tell pale-hearted fear of lies and sleep in spite of thunder. What is this?
Listen.
But speak not to it.
Be lion, nettle proud, and take no care. Who shafts, who frets, or where conspires are, Macbeth shall never vanquish. The Entail, great Burnham Wood, high Nunsinane Hill shall come against him.
That will never be. Who can impress the forest? Bid the tree unfix his earthbound root. Ah, sweet bodiment, good. Yet, my heart throbs to know one thing. Tell me, if your art can tell so much, shall Banquo's kingdom ever reign in this kingdom?
Seek to know no more.
I will be satisfied. Deny me this, and an eternal curse fall on you. Let me know! Why sinks that cauldron? And what noise is this?
Show!
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 Show
his eyes and grieve his heart! Come like shadows, so depart!
Thou art too like the spirit of Banquo. Down! Thy crown to sear mine eyeballs. Thy hair, thou other gold-bound brow is like the first. A third is like the former.
Filthy hags, why do you show me this?
A fourth start. Eyes, what? Will this line stretch out to the crack of doom? Another yet? A seventh? I'll see no more. And yet, the eighth appears, who bears a glass which shows me many more. Some I see that twofold balls and triple scepters carry all. Horrible sight. Now I see 'tis true. For the blood bolts and Banquo smiles upon me and points at them for his. What? Is this so?
Why, sir, all this is so. But why stands Macbeth thus amazingly?
Aye, sir.
Come, sister.
All this is so.
Up his but
why stands Macbeth thus amazingly?
Aye,
sir.
I'll show you
this
is so.
This great king may kindly say our duties did. welcome pay.
Saw you the weird sisters?
No, my lord.
Came they not by you?
No, indeed, my lord.
Infected be the air whereon they ride, and damn go loose that cross them. I did hear the galloping of horse. Who was it came by?
'Tis tier three, my lord, that send you word Macduff is fled to England.
Fled to England?
Aye, my good lord.
Time, thou anticipatest my dread exploits. The flighty purpose is never o'ertook unless the deed go with it. From this moment, the very first things of my heart shall be the first things of my hand. And even now, to crown my thoughts with acts, be it thought and done, the castle of Macduff I will surprise. Seize upon Fife, give to the edge of the sword his wife, his babes, and all unfortunate souls that trace him in his line. No boasting like a fool. This deed I'll do before this purpose cool. But no more sights. Where are these gentlemen? Come, bring me where they are.
What had he done to make him fly the land?
You must have patience, madam.
He had none. His flight was madness. What our actions do not, our fears do make us traitors.
You know not whether it was his wisdom or his fear.
Wisdom! To leave his wife, to leave his babes, his mansion and his titles in a place from whence himself does fly. He loves us not. He wants the natural touch. For the poor wren, the most diminutive of birds, will fight her young ones in her nest against the owl. All is the fear, and nothing is the love.
Might
so little is the wisdom, for his flight so runs against all reason.
My dearest cuz, I pray you school yourself. But for your husband, he is wise, noble, judicious, and best knows the fits of the season. I dare not speak much further, but cruel are the times when we are the traitors and do not know ourselves. When we hold rumor from what we fear, yet know not what we fear, but float upon a wild and violent sea, each way and none. I take my leave of you. Shall not be long. I'll be here again. Things at the worst will cease or else climb upwards of what they were before. My pretty cousin, blessing upon you.
Father he is, and yet he's fatherless.
I am so much a fool should I stay longer. It would be to my disgrace and your discomfort. I take my leave at once.
Sirrah, your father's dead. And what will you do now? How will you live?
Mother.
What? With worms and flies?
With what I get, I mean, and so do they.
Poor bird. Thou'st never fear the net nor line, pitfall nor the gin.
Why should I, mother? Poor birds they're not set for. My father's not dead, for I was saying.
Yes, he is dead. And how wilt thou do for a father?
Nay, how thou do for a husband?
Why, I could buy me 20 at any market.
You'd buy him to sell again.
Thou speaks with all thy wit, and yet in faith with wit enough for thee.
Was my father a traitor, mother?
Aye, that he was.
And what is a traitor?
Why? One that swears and lies.
And be all true as I do so.
Everyone that does so is a traitor and must be hanged.
And all that swear and lie must be hanged?
Everyone.
Well, who must hang them?
Why, the honest men.
These swears and liars are fools. If there are swears and liars enough to beat out the honest men and hang them.
Now, God help thee, poor monkey. But how wilt thou do for a father?
If my father were dead, you'd leave for him. If he were not, that were a good sign that I should quickly have a new father.
Poor prattler, how thou talkst.
Bless you, fair dame. I doubt some days approach you nearly. If you take a homely man's advice, be not found here, hence the little one. Heaven preserve you. I dare abide no longer.
Whither should I fly? I have done no harm. And yet I remember now I am in this world where to do harm is often laudable. To do good often accounted dangerous. Father, why then? Alas, do I put up that womanly defense to say I have done no harm? What are these faces?
Where is your husband?
I hope in no place so unsanctified where such as thou mayst find him.
He is a traitor.
Thou liest, thou shagger villain!
Out some desolate shade and weep our sad bosoms empty.
Let us rather hold fast our mortal sword and, like good men, bestride our downfallen birthdom. Each new morn, new widows howl, new orphans cry, and new sorrows strike heaven upon the face.
Would I believe all well? What you have spoke may be so perchance that this tyrant, whose sole name blisters our tongues, was once thought honest. You have loved him well. He hath not touched you yet. I am young to offer up a poor, weak, innocent lamb to appease an angry god.
I am not treacherous.
But Macbeth is.
I've lost my hopes.
Even so, perchance, where I did find my doubts, why in that rawness left you wife and child?
Believe, believe, poor country. Great tyranny, lay thou thy base assure. For goodness dare not check thee. Fare thee well, for I would not be the villain that thou thinkest.
Be not offended. I speak as in not an absolute fear of you. I think our country sinks beneath the yoke. It weeps, it bleeds, and each new day a gash is added to her wounds. I think withal, hands should be uplifted in my right, and from gracious England to offer up goodly thousands. When shall I tread upon the tyrant's head or wear it on my sword? Yet my poor country shall have more vices, more suffer in sundry ways than before, by him that shall succeed.
What should he be?
It is in myself that I know that when they cut him open, black Macbeth will seem as pure as snow.
Not in the legions of hell is there a devil more damned than top Macbeth.
I grant him bloody. False, deceitful, sudden, malicious, smacking of every sin that has a name. But there is no bottom, none in my voluptuousness. Your wives, your daughters, your matrons, your maids cannot fill up the cistern of my lust. Better Macbeth than one to reign.
Boundless intemperance in nature is a tyranny. Hath been the untimely emptying of the happy throne and fall of many kings. But do not be afraid to take upon you what is yours.
With this there grows such a staunchless avarice. Were I king, I should cut off the nobles for their lands, desire his jewels or this other's house, destroying them for wealth.
This avarice hath been the sword of our slain kings. But do not fear, Scotland hath poisons to fill your will. All of these are portable, with other graces weighed.
but I have none.
Oh, Scotland, Scotland!
If one be fit to govern, speak! I am as I've spoken.
Fit to govern? No, not to live! O nation miserable, when shalt thou see thy wholesome days again? Fare thee well. These evils thou repeatest upon thyself have banished me from Scotland. Oh, my breast, I hope ends here.
Macduff, this noble passion, child of integrity, hath from my soul wiped the black scruples, reconciled my thoughts to thy good truth and honor. I am yet unknown to woman, never was forsworn, scarcely as coveted what was mine own, never would betray a devil to his fellow. My only false speaking was this, and what I am truly is thine and my poor country's to command. Why are you silent?
Such welcome and unwelcome things at once, it's hard to reconcile. See, who comes here?
My countrymen, but yet I know him not.
My ever gentle cousins, welcome hither.
Ah, I know him now. May God remove the means that make us strangers.
Sir, amen.
Stand Scotland where it did?
Alas, poor country, almost afraid to know itself. It cannot be called our mother, but our grave. Where nothing but who knows nothing was once seen to smile. Where sighs and groans and shrieks that rend the air made not marked. And where violent sorrow seems a modern ecstasy. The dead man's knell is there scarce asked for who. And good men's lives expire before the flowers in their caps die or sicken.
Oh, relation, too nice and yet too true.
Ah, what's the newest grief?
How does my wife?
Why, well.
And all my children?
Well, too.
The tyrant has not battered at their peace?
No, they were well at peace when I did leave them.
Be not short of your breath, how goes it?
When I came hither to transport the tidings, which I have heavily borne, there ran a rumor of many fellows that were out, which was to my belief witnessed, rather, for that I saw the tyrant's power foot. Now is the time of help. Your eye in Scotland would create soldiers, make our women fight to doff their dire distresses.
Be it their comfort. We are coming thither. Gracious England hath lent us good seaward and 10,000 men, a better soldier than none that Christendom does give out.
Would I could answer this comfort with the like, but I have words that would be howled out in the desert air, where hearing could not latch them.
What concern there?
No mind that's honest, but in it sure some woe, though the main part pertains to you alone.
If it be mine, keep it not from me. Quickly let me have it.
Let your ears not despise my tongue forever. Your castle is surprised. Your wife and babes savagely slaughtered.
Merciful heaven!
All my children?
Wife, children, servants, all that could be found.
I must be from thence. My wife killed too.
I have said.
Be comforted. Let's make us the medicines of great revenge to cure this deadly grief.
He has no children. Oh, my pretty ones. Did you say all? Oh, my pretty chickens. Damn, at one fell swoop.
Dispute it like a man.
I will. But I must also feel it as a man. I cannot but remember such things so precious. Did the heavens look on and did not take their part? Sinful Macduff, they were struck for thee. Thou slaughter on their souls. Heaven rest them now.
Be this the whetstone of your sword. Let grief convert to anger. Do not blunt the heart, enrage it.
Consort all into mission. Front to front, bring down this. Scotland, within my sword's length, set him. If he escape, heaven forgive him too.
Ha! This tune goes manly. Come, we go to the king. Our power is I have 2 nights walked with you and can perceive no truth in your report. When was it she last walked?
Since His Majesty went in the field, I have seen her rise from her bed, throw her nightgown upon her, unlock her closet, take forth paper, fold it, write upon it, read it, afterwards seal it, and again return to bed, yet all this while being the most fast asleep.
A great perturbation of nature to receive the benefits of sleep while doing the effects of watching. In this slumbering agitation, besides walking and any other actual performances, what at any time have you heard her say?
That, sir, which I will not report after her.
You may to me, and 'tis most you should.
Neither do you nor anyone, having no witness to confirm my speech.
Lo you, here she comes. This is her very guise. And upon my wife, fast asleep, observe her, stand close. How came she by that light?
Why, it stood by her. She has light by her continually. 'Tis her command.
You see, her eyes are open.
Aye, but their senses shut.
What is it she does now? Look, how she rubs her hands.
It is a custom action by her to seem thus washing her hands. I have known her to continue this a quarter of an hour. Yet, here's a spot.
Hark, she speaks. I will set down what comes for her to further satisfy my remembrance more strongly.
Out, dance spot, out, I say! What? Why then, 'tis time to do it. Hell is murky. Fie, my lord, fie. A soldier and a feared? What need we fear who knows it when none can call her power to account? Yet, who would have thought the old man to have so much blood in him?
Do you mark that?
The Thane of Fife had a wife. Where is she now?
Go to,
no more of that, my lord. No more of that. Mar all with this starting.
Go to, you know what you should not.
She has spoke what she should not. Heaven knows what she has known. There's the smell of blood still. All the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand. Oh, oh, oh!
What a sigh is there. The heart is sorely charged.
I would not have such a heart in my bosom for the dignity of the whole body.
Well, it was well.
Pray God it be, sir.
This disease is beyond my practice, and I have known those who have walked in their sleep and who have died wholly in their beds.
Well, wash your hands. Put on your nightgown. Look not so pale. I tell you yet again, Bangor's buried. He cannot come out on his grave.
Even so.
To bed. To bed. There's a knocking at the gate. Come, 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 come. Give me your hand. What's done cannot be undone. It's bed, it's bed, bed.
Will she now go to bed?
Directly.
Foul whisperings abroad. Unnatural deeds do breed unnatural troubles. Infected minds to their death pals will discharge their secrets. More she needs the divine than a physician. God, God forgive us all. Look after her. Remove her from all means of annoyances and keep eyes upon her. So good night. My mind she has maided, and my sight she has amazed. But I think, but I dare not speak.
Good night, good doctor.
The English power is near, led on by Malcolm, his uncle Seward, and the good Macduff. Revenges burn in them.
Your burn avoids shall we meet them. That way they are coming.
Here goes Donald Bainby with his brother.
For certain, sir, he is not. I have a list of all the gentry. There is Seward's son, and many youths who even now protest the thirst of manhood.
But what does the tyrant Macbeth?
Great guns and Amy strongly fortifies. Some say he's mad. Others that lesser hate him do call it valiant fear. But for certain, he cannot buckle his distempered claws within belt rule.
Now does he feel secret murders sticking upon his hands. Now those who he commands with only a command, nothing in love. Now does he feel his title hang upon him like giant's robes upon a dwarvish thief.
But who then shall blame him when all that is within him does condemn itself for being there?
will march me on to give obedience where 'tis truly owed. Meet we Malcolm, and with him pour we in our country's purge, each drop of us.
Or so much as it needs to do the sovereign flower and drown the weed. Make we our march toward Burnham.
I cannot taint with fear. What's the boy Malcolm? Was he not born of woman? The spirits that know all mortal consequences have pronounced me thus. Fear not, Macbeth, for no man that's born of woman shall e'er have power upon thee. Then fly, false thanes, and mingle with the English epicures. The devil damn thee black, thou cream-faced moon. Where goddest thou that goose look?
There are 10,000.
Geese, villain?
Soldier, sir.
Go prick thy face and overread thy fear, thou lily-livered boy. What soldier's way, face?
The English force, sir, please you.
Take thy face hence. Seaton! I am sick at heart when I behold. Seaton, I say! This will cheer me ever or deceit me now. I have lived long enough. My way of life is fallen into the sear, the yellow leaf, and that which should accompany old age is honor, love, obedience, troops of friends, I must not look to have, but in their stead curses. Satan!
What's the gracious pleasure?
What news more?
All has been confirmed, my lord, which was reported.
I will fight till from my bones my flesh be hacked. Give me mine armor.
Is not needed yet.
I'll put it on. Send out more horses. Scour the country round. Hang those that talk of fear. Give me mine armor. How dost thou, patient doctor?
Not so sick, my lord, as she is troubled with thick coming fantasies that keep her from her rest.
Cure her of that. Canst thou not minister to a mind diseased, and with some sweet, oblivious antidote, cleanse the stuffed bosom of that perilous stuff which weighs upon the heart?
Therein the patient must minister to himself, my lord.
Don't kiss me, son of dogs. Out none of it. Come, put mine armor on. Give me my staff. Seaton, send out. Doctor, the thanes fly from me. Come, sir, dispatch. If thou couldest, doctor, cast the water of my land. Find her disease and purge it to a sound and pristine health. I would applaud thee to the very echo that would applaud again.
Aye, my good lord.
Bring it after me. I will not be afraid of death and bane till Burnham Forest come to Dunsinane.
Were I from Dunsinane away,
clear profit again should hardly draw me near. Cousins! I hope the days are near at hand that Chambers will be safe.
We doubted nothing. What wood is this before us? The wood of Burnham.
Let every soldier hew him down about and bear it before him. Thereby shall we shadow the numbers of our host.
Shall be done!
The confident tyrant keeps still in Dunsinane, and Will and Dor are setting down before it.
'Tis his main hope, for where there is advantage to be given. Both more or less have given him the revolt. And let us not be of constrained things whose hearts are absent too.
Let our just censures attend the true event and put we on industrious soldiership.
Hang out our banners on the outer walls. The cries still they come. Our castle's strength will lack a siege to scorn. Here, let them lie till famine and ague eat them up. What is that noise?
It's a cry of wound, my lord.
I have almost forgotten the taste of fears. The time has been my senses would have cooled to hear a night shriek. I have supped full with horrors. Direness familiar to my slaughterous thoughts cannot once start me. Wherefore was that cry?
The queen, my lord, is dead.
You should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow. It is a poor player who struts and frets his hour upon the stage, and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. Thou comest to use thy tongue. Thy story quickly.
Gracious my lord, I shall report that which I say I saw, but I do not know how to do it.
Well, say, sir.
As I stand my watch upon the hill, I look towards Burnham, and in my thought, the wood began to move.
Liar! And slave!
Gracious my lord, I shall endure my wrath and it not to be so. Within 3 miles you may see it coming, I say, a moving grove.
If thou speakest false, upon the next tree shall thou hang alive, for damn it claim thee! If thy speech be soothed, I care not if thou dost for me as much. I pull in resolution and begin to doubt the equivocation of the being that lies like truth. Fear not till Burnham Wood do come to Dunsinane. And now a wood comes towards Dunsinane. Arm and out. If this which he avouches does appear, there's nor flying hence nor tarrying here. I begin to be weary of the sun, and wish the estate of the world were now undone. Ring the alarm bells, blow wind, come rack! At least we'll die with harness on our back.
Worthy uncle, you, with my cousin, your right and noble son, lead our first battle. Macduff and we shall take upon what else remains to do, according to our order.
Fare you well. Do we but find the tyrant's powers tonight? Let us be beaten if we cannot fight.
Make all our trumpets speak, give them all breath, those clamorous harbingers of blood and death.
Such a one am I to fear, or none!
What's thy name?
Thou wilt be afraid to hear it.
No, though thou callest thyself a hotter name than any is in hell.
My name's Macbeth.
The devil himself cannot pronounce a title more hateful to mine ear.
No, nor more fearful.
Thou liest aboard, tyrant. If my sword approved lie thou speakest.
Thou wast born a woman, but swords I smile at, weapons laugh to scorn, brandished by man that's of a woman born. Ha!
That way the noise is. Tyrant, show thy face! Thou shalt be slain, and by no stroke of mine! My wife and children's ghost will haunt me still. Let me find them, fortune. More I beg not.
Here, my lord.
Ha! The foes that strike beside us!
Enter, sir, the castle.
Why should I play the Roman fool and die on mine own sword. Whiles I see lives, the gashes do better upon them.
Turn, hellhound, turn!
Of all men else, I have avoided thee, but get thee back. My soul is too much charged with blood of thine already.
I have no words. My voice is in my sword. Thou bloodier villain, the terms could give thee out.
Thou losest labor. Let fall thy blade on vulnerable crests. I bear a charmed life, which must not yield to one of woman born.
Spare thy charm, and let the angel that still has served tell that Macduff was from his mother's womb untimely ripped.
Accursed be the tongue that tells me so, for death cowed my better part of man. And be these juggling fiends no more believed that powder with us in a devil's sins, that keep the word of promise to our ears and break it to our hopes. I'll not fight with thee.
Then yield thee, coward.
I will not yield. To kiss the ground before young Malcolm's feet, and to be baited with the rabble's curse. Though Vernon would be come to Dunsan, and thou oppose it, you know no woman born yet. I will try the last. Before my body, I throw my warlike shield. Lay on, Macduff, and damn be him that first cries, hold! Enough!
I hope the friends we miss are safe arrived.
Some must go off, and yet, by these I see, so great a day is cheaply bought.
Macduff is missing, and your noble son.
Your son, my lord, has paid a soldier's debt, but like a man he died.
Then he is dead?
Aye, and brought off the field. Your cause of sorrow must not be measured by his worth, for then it hath no end.
Had he his hearse before?
Aye, on the front.
Why, then, God's soldier be he?
He's worth more sorrow, and that I shall spend for him.
He's worth no more. They say he parted well and paid his score. And for that, God be with my son. Here comes newer comfort.
So thou art. Behold where stands the usurper's cursed head. The time is free. Hail, King of Scotland.
Hail, King of Scotland.
My thanes and kingsmen, henceforth be earls, and first such an honor Scotland named. What's more to do, which would be planted newly with the time, as calling home our exiled friends abroad, that fled the snares of watchful tyranny, producing forth the cruel ministers of this dead butcher and his fiend-like queen, who his tis thought myself, and violent hands took off her life. This, and what needful else that we call upon by the grace of grace, we will perform in time, measure, and place. So thanks to all and to each one whom we invite to see us crowned at Skye.
Let's all just stand together. So, this is my friend Haley, by the way. For those of you, I have a speaker system. Just give me a second. Okay, so for those of you that don't know, I'm Jacob Bonds. I am the stage manager for the drama department. This is my first year. First and foremost, I would like to thank you all for coming out. It means a lot to us. Whether it be dropping us off at rehearsals, keeping us positive, or just like showing up and clapping for us, it means the world to us. We would be nothing without you all. First, I would like to thank a few people who acted in this show, including the witches. Mr. Winterode. Ms. Shelton and Ms. Scheffler. And of course, the one and only Dr. Freeman. Also, I would like to thank my crew, Anna Guestwick and Corinne Anderson. And now comes the sad part. Since this is mine and several others' last play, I would like to say something about my fellow seniors who I have worked alongside during my 4 years in the drama department. Every person that I have come into contact with during my experience has formed a bond with me and everybody else I've worked with. First off, one of my closest friends, Beatrice Goodwin. Beatrice has been acting for drama for the longest time and has developed a close bond with every actor that has stood on the stage, including myself. Beatrice is a fantastic actress. She always takes one of the lead roles in every play we put on. She's a terrific person and friend, and I will miss seeing her perform on stage as well as every day. I love you. The magnificent but gory Aiden Bryant. She has worked many positions during her time in drama. Last year she worked as my assistant stage manager, makeup artist, costume manager, and anything else I asked of her. I have seen her tackle so many obstacles over the past few years, and am incredibly proud of what she has accomplished. We have become close friends as well, especially over the past year or so, and I can hope it continues even after our time in high school together. I love you too. Next, my best friend, Josh Chisholm. Josh came to BSH this year and participated in both Charlotte's Web and this production. Josh has the unique ability to befriend everybody that he comes into contact with, and make a group of people, or even entire class, feel as though they are family. And that is exactly what he has done with the drama department and the senior class. He sticks with the tough tasks and succeeds in every role he takes on. I know I speak for the entire drama department when I say that we are incredibly grateful that we have met you this year. David. David is one of the funniest people I've ever met. He is sarcastic. I mean, says anything to do with Jake Warren whenever it comes into his head. David has acted in a few productions, and I have seen him tackle a variety of roles, each of them better and better. David is one of the funniest people I know, and I am happy to have met him. However, one flaw David has is being completely over-obsessed with hating the fact that people put pineapple on pizza.
It's a crime against you.
Now we'll move down there. I can't see you, but we'll move down there anyway. Next is Jack Williams. Jack has worked as a main sound and light guy for the drama department since before I came to BSH. Jack is a reliable source for myself, Mrs. Dickerson, Mrs. O'Brien, or anybody else relying on him to create a well-lit, great-sounding production, and he always follows through. I started working in drama with Jack, and he has taught me many of the basic components of having success in the theater. And I've always been grateful to him for that. Also on the sound light crew, James Heldman. James is essential to the drama department, and I'm sure everybody agrees when I say that we are glad you came to work with us over the past few years. Now I have a few people I need to thank on my own. First, I would like to thank the one and only Liza Moore. Liza is a graduate of BSH and now attends BCU, majoring in art history. During my first 3 years in the drama department, Liza taught me, complained to me, supported me, and of course made me into the person I am today. Everything I've learned has been of the teachings of Liza, and I could not be more thankful for her. She's the reason I have been so successful as head stage manager this year. She is one of the most important people in my life, and I will miss her greatly when I go off to college next year. Finally, from all of us here on stage, I would like to thank our wonderful directors, Mrs. Catherine Dickerson and Mrs. Martha O'Brien. They have both been the directors ever since I set foot on BSH, and I've never seen either of them lose hope in a single actor, actress, or person working on stage crew. They exude so much love and support to every single person that is willing to set foot on the stage. We all look up to you both and hope to someday have the ability to tackle as many obstacles with as much grace as you both do every day. Of thankfulness and love, the drama department would like to present you both with $100 gift cards to the Cheesecake Factory, as well as bouquets of flowers. I am forever thankful for my experience with the drama department and have loved every second I've spent with everybody on the stage. Thank you.
Logged 8 hours a week since Christmas, including reading the play itself over Christmas. So I thank you, and I love you, and I thank you. Beast of a play, and I have never been happier.